Start going.
We are recording.
Good. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
How are we doing tonight? Right. Tonight. Yes, it is the slightly default happy, isn't it? And that was my first question. Was we've got two ways of going tonight, and I really, really don't mind. Okay. So this session, I designed this session with a sneaking suspicion we might be a bit default happy. So we can listen to more music or we can listen to less music. Okay? So if you want to get away earlier, we'll listen to less. If you're feeling a bit tired, if you're feeling you're a bit music out. I've got a lot of musical examples and I think they're all pretty enjoyable and pretty accessible, but you know, if you are tired and you're thinking, you know, here and just give us the light version tonight, that is absolutely fine. So, is anyone brave enough? And I don't mean brave enough because I'm not offended either way. Does anyone have a preference? Do you want to just sort of get through and get to the pub, or do you want to wallow in some wonderful late romantic music?
I think we need to hear it first.
What's that?
Yeah, okay.
I tell you what, we'll go through, and you get a taste of what we need. And then you can say this, so you can say, hey, let me pray, and then we'll jump in. Father, thank you again for the wonderful world you've given us. Thank you for beauty. Thank you for people. Thank you for humanity. Thank you for making us, putting us in this world. And Father, we are so sorry for what we've done to it. But Father, we're so grateful that you have sent your Son to fix us, to fix the world we broke. And Father, we are so excited that one day we get to see a new heaven and a new earth, and we get to spend it with Jesus in all his and all its and all our perfection, as it will be. And Father, we want to say thank you. We want to say we love you. Father, we want to pray that you would guide our thoughts and guide our my words, especially this. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So you can tell I'm tired. I've got the wrong talk. Here we go.
You should just have tried it and see if anyone noticed.
Oh dear, this would be interesting. All right, here we go. I do apologize. Okay, so what's your favourite ism? Anyone got a favourite ism? Do you know what I mean? Yeah, you know what I mean, right? We talked about a few isms. Modernism, postmodernism, some of it. I'm sure you know a few that I don't even know. What's your favourite? Which attracts you the most? Anyone want to volunteer?
In music, romanticism.
Romanticism, yeah, okay. Yeah. Anybody else? Maybe, you know, it's a life philosophy. You know.
Creationism.
Mm-hmm. There's a right answer to this. You know, it's okay because I'm gonna confess boldly to you now because this is
quite like prisms.
Okay, I should keep talking.
Is there such a thing as grammaticism?
Is that what that one? Pedantricism.
Pedanticism.
Okay, so this is what we're looking at today. This is my favouriteism, okay? I find this idea of romanticism that we've been looking at today, I find that just so attractive. You know, if I'm going to gravitate anywhere other than Jesus, I'm probably going to go this direction. The rugged individual rising, elevating him or herself above adversity, and so on. I love this stuff. I really find this very intoxicating. Or at least part of me does. And then I remember that actually this is straight out of Genesis 3. Can I read Genesis 3, 1 to 7? Now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God actually say, 'You shall not eat of any tree in the garden?'" And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden. But God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the midst of the garden, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. But the serpent said to the woman, you will not surely die. For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate, and she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loincloths. The lie of the devil here is based on autonomy. Do you notice that? It centers on the falsehood that man and woman will be better off, will be far more fulfilled, will be more enlightened. And they can only reach their true potential when they break away from relationship with God. If I can paraphrase, he doesn't love you. In fact, he's rather scared of you. He's intimidated by your potential. He knows what you could achieve. That's why he wants to hem you in. That's why he wants to control you. That's why he wants to restrict you. But oh, the delights that await you if you would only grow up and be your own people. You will be like him. You will be gods yourselves. Sweep him aside. And thus subtly, persuasively, and hideously, Satan redefines God. Not as love, but as power. And who wants to submit to power when power could be theirs to own themselves? You can almost hear him whispering this stuff into Siegfried's ear, can't you? Not that Wotan is even a pale reflection of the God of Scripture. Devil doesn't have to try and reinvent Wotan. But keep this in mind as we move through this evening and we look at late Romanticism and the death of the myth. Let's listen to some music. And this is music by Gustav Mahler, one of my favourite composers. Now Gustav Mahler, for many commentators, provides the real substantial bridge between Romanticism and where we started this week with modernity. Tolkien believed in the importance of the act of sub-creation. You come across that idea in Tolkien. The fact that we as creatures reflect our Creator's glory in our own acts of creation. And thus Tolkien was a sub-creator par excellence, really, wasn't he? With his own world, literally, well, almost literally, of Middle Earth, with its rich history of three ages, with its own geography, with its own languages, with its own flora and fauna and all that stuff. Tolkien was better than most at creating worlds. And I find it more than a little intriguing that Gustav Mahler famously commented, for me, to write a symphony is to create a world. Here's an extract from Mahler's Fifth Symphony. If you only know one piece, one little bit of Mahler, it's probably this one, and understandably so. So see what you think of the Adagietto from Mahler Symphony number 5.
Thank you. wonderful stuff. That's probably the best known of Mahler's works and extract, opinion of his best known extracts. And it's straight out of the Tristan and Isolde playbook. I don't know if you noticed. Right at the beginning there, you know, it's very difficult to know how the harmony is working. That melody kind of, not even sure what key we're in. The melody just kind of emerges and a key is kind of eventually settled on. Leonard Bernstein is conducting that unbelievably good performance. His control of the sounds, just extraordinary. Bernstein was crazy about Mahler and gave lectures in Harvard University on the link between linguistics and music. Fascinating. If you're interested in linguistics and chasing its connection with music, it's a series of lectures called The Unanswered Question. And Bernstein gives a lecture on this piece and on what's going on there. And he speaks of the beautiful ambiguity in this music. And Mahler has this, he's really picked up that idea from Tristan. He adored Wagner. And he's really getting that same idea, that same sound world that Wagner has at the beginning of Tristan and Isolde that we listened to at the end of the last session. And that, by the way, is his wonderfully sensual love letter that he pens to his new bride, Alma, who he just married when he'd written this music. So it's just incredibly romantic, beautifully crafted music. But to my ears, at least, this music, like the Wagner we listened to last time, is still largely rooted in Romanticism. Even the beginnings of modernism are undoubtedly starting to show, as we saw with Wagner, I think we can definitely see elements, early stage modernist art going on here. But it's still largely rooted in Romanticism, at least for my ears. And one of the big problems for Romanticism with its incredible optimism for humanity that we saw earlier was the inevitable. And it was spelled out for us from the very beginning. That's why I read from Genesis 3 earlier. You will not surely die like the serpent. It's almost as though he was saying, isn't it? Look at me. Am I dead? And the true answer that Eve could have given him, of course, was yes. You died the moment you broke relationship with God, who is life. Physical death, the delayed inevitable, was only the outworking of the spiritual death, which came with humanity's turning from God. And the serpent knew this very well, of course, but his lies reduced death, interestingly, to just the physical, as he painted the supposed liberty and enlightenment of what he was promising as real life. You see the inversion of everything true in Genesis 3. But physical death must be confronted sooner or later, and not even the romantics were exempt. Thomas just spelled that out for us so hopefully and brilliantly this afternoon, isn't he? It's the Uberman might climb any mountain, might cast his glorious eyes down on a sea of fog or overcome any number of adversities, but eventually he must face the inevitable, his own mortality, just like our wanderer in Winterreiser this afternoon. Even Siegfried himself doesn't make it to the end of the ring cycle. Sorry, that's a spoiler, but romanticism, like many philosophies, has its nuances and even paradoxes. On the one hand, we find the enormous optimism and humanism of something like Siegfried. On the other hand, we have the bleak and the desperate longing of something like Winterreiser, as Tom showed us so brilliantly earlier on. As the 19th century drew to a close, in music at least, romanticism was struggling under its own weight, finding it difficult to maintain its optimistic posture, and is often found leaning more towards, I think, the world of Winterreiser than it's leaning towards the world of the optimism of Siegfried. And the various revolutions of the 19th century have brought exciting new developments and perspectives and possibilities, but alongside them came new problems and not utopian societies as people have been hoping. So, I mean, you can see this perhaps most clearly in something like the Industrial Revolution. Huge stride forwards in technology and
production techniques and so on had improved a range, had improved efficiency, transformed the way we worked, made an awful lot of wealth for certain individuals. But the industrial boom brought with it a whole range of social problems, often horrific in nature and scale, which came as a direct result of industrialization and consequent urbanization. And the Romantics were struggling to find the answers. Think of a writer like Charles Dickens, who often writes, personifies the city, the urban space, you know, as this big, black, monolithic, breathing, hideous places, you know, that dehumanize and so on. We're not quite done with Wagner yet, because how about this for a piece of prophetic writing from the man himself? I hate this fast-growing tendency to chain men to machines in big factories and deprive them of all joy in their efforts. The plan will lead to cheap men and cheap products. Not everything Wagner said was awful. Very true. Thus, in the later Romantic period, composers' thoughts often became noticeably more pessimistic and inward-looking and dark, reflecting Schubert. Now's a good time to talk about Russia's greatest Romantic composer, Tchaikovsky, as a perfect example of this. And I'd like to spend a bit of time in Tchaikovsky's last symphony, the Sixth Symphony. I'll give you a bit of background about it later. Let's just listen to the music for what it is right now. So here's how the symphony opens. Here's the beginning of the first movement. I think you'd agree that's a fairly gloomy opening, isn't it? Did you notice how Tchaikovsky chose his palette very, very carefully there? Very prominent low strings, divided double basses, cellos, violas, horns, bassoons, clarinets, some oboes just towards the end as well. All chosen to give a particularly dark-hued, gloomy scene. Those sweet violins, noticeable, conspicuous by their absence, you know. Violins rarely start with a big rest as they do in the symphony, but he doesn't want those bright, sweet sounds. They come in there later, but everything here is designed to create this dark, dark world, dark sound world, and gloomy opening. Think of that melody. Oh. struggling to rouse itself. It's struggling upward just about, and then collapses again. And that's really the shape of the whole symphony. You know, just as Beethoven, we get a symphony out of four notes, so to Tchaikovsky, and so he does. That arc is really the shape of the whole four movements. It's a disturbing, it's a gloomy, it's an aching setting of the scene. But there's nothing that unusual about this, about a 19th century symphony with a gloomy opening. A symphonic journey that moves from struggle to victory, from darkness to light, was a favourite model with composers since Beethoven and earlier. And as we've seen, that's completely in keeping with the romantic spirit. Remember that melancholy opening we heard to Mendelssohn earlier, the Scottish symphony. And that ends in great light, great joy. The romantics had a long love affair with the twilight. So let's see how Tchaikovsky carries on. Maybe he's going to end up in some beautiful victory. So here's the second movement. Now the second movement is a dance movement, and that's conventional enough. Symphonies usually had a dance movement, often a minuet in the 18th century. We saw the minuet in Figaro, you remember. Figaro dances the minuet, the courtly dance. And that's often a second or third movement in a symphony. Beethoven seemed to replace the minuet with the scherzo, which is literally a joke in his symphonies. But those movements never really lost the quality or the joy of the dance. And Tchaikovsky loved dance, remember. He's most famous, perhaps, as a ballet composer. Swan Lake, Sleeping Beauty, Nutcracker. And he was a brilliant writer of waltzes. And we've heard some waltzes this week. Let's see what he serves up here for his dance movement, for the second movement. Here we go. Observations there. What do you think of that dance?
Rhythms seem mixed up.
Right. And do you like to elaborate?
There's twos and threes. And...
Right. Yeah. So it's a dance. It's almost a waltz. But it's hard to dance in 5 beats to a bar.
Yeah. It changes and switches. And...
Right. Right. So what's going on here? Then? One, two, three, four, five. One, two, three, four, five. I don't know much about dancing, but I'm pretty sure dancing in 5 beats is really difficult. Because you've got a limp. The music has a limp.
Five feet.
And so on. And so this is a dance, but not as we know it. This is a graceful movement, but it limps. It walks with a limp. It hides it well. There's a real effort and stability here, but it's understated. There's an attempt to hide the limp, but the person, like, the dance is out of balance. We could even say the times are out of joint. So there's, beneath this veneer, there's something clearly not right. There's something that's not quite sticking together. Let's see how he gets on. Thank you. What do you think? Any thoughts? A bit more like it?
Like frantic, panicky, overwhelming.
Right. Interesting. Yeah. Good. No, it's helpful. It's very helpful. Any other thoughts?
There's a switch in tempo.
Right.
But I think there's the odd little limp in the middle of it somewhere, but I'm not sure if I have that right.
The tempo stays the same.
Does it?
But there's some little moments, little awkward things. I know as a conductor, you've got some very awkward moments to negotiate. Yeah, but the pulse is essentially the same. But I know what you mean. Yeah.
You've got a rather chirpy melody.
Yeah.
But then it's, at various points, it's being overwhelmed by all this other stuff.
Right.
It seems to sort of flood it.
Yes. Yeah. And so there's so much going on. It's very panicky. I'm interested you use that word, you know, and you know, there's an awful lot going on here, isn't there? You know, the nutcracker, you know, this is where you'll notice, you know, people were asking what difference does a conductor make? You know, you could go that's very sugary and very sweet and fairy music, you know, nutcracker stuff. Or, and I think you're right, in this performance, there's something a little more subversive going on here. But there is at least that tune, isn't it? It's a pretty jolly march, you know, at least on the surface. Now, this is real, you know, classic Tchaikovsky. He was brilliant at writing music for dancers, and he was great at rousing finales and giving people a big tune that would put them, you know, with spring on this in this step and whistling as he went home, you know. As they leave the theatre, you know, Tchaikovsky was just fantastic at it, you know, leave them only more and all that. And this is, you know, good stuff. This is going to be the rousing finale, isn't it? And listen to Tchaikovsky's previous five symphonies, and this is where he lands, this blazing light out of the darkness. But you might have guessed, this is not the finale. This is the third movement. So I think what we could do now is listen to the end of the third movement and then go straight into the fourth movement without any comment from me. And the fourth movement is quite short, so I'm going to I think we'll listen to the whole thing. So listen to the end of the third movement and then listen to what comes next. So. name deeds of the first performance of this Tchaikovsky's greatest work, He Was Dead. Was it suicide? Was it cholera from drinking unboiled water? We'll probably never know for certain. But for Tchaikovsky, in his final symphony, he confronted the inevitable with a symphony which closes as it began. Did you notice the bow strings, the utter darkness collapsing under its own weight, resigned to the darkness? Did you notice how the melody always moved downwards? Every time it took a step up, it's always to go down again. Apart from one rising figure in the middle where he musters up one last sort of anguished cry, and of course, total dissolving. It's a dear piece to my heart, as things happened. It was a piece I conducted 9 days after my brother died. Mm. These things are planned, you know, years ahead, and that's how the diary worked out. But, it was a very cathartic moment for me in some ways, doing that. But anyway, that's just a personal note on that. Mm. Composers had dabbled with sad endings before, but really dabbled. You know, nobody had done anything as boldly or as devastating as this. Interesting little anecdote with that symphony. The Soviet Union didn't really know what to do with this piece because Tchaikovsky was, by most people's opinion, Russia's greatest symphonist, greatest romantic composer, and this is his greatest work. What do you do if you're the Soviet authorities and you've got this symphony? Swap the last two movements around. So, and under the Soviet Union, it was often performed 1, 2, 4, what we just heard, and then they finished under the march. Go figure. The seeds of modernism were growing. Musical language was already fermenting, in which these traditional models of functional harmony were being overturned, and sound was being offered in the abstract. We saw that in Tristan and Isolde, we saw that in the opening of the Mahler. And ideologically, this element of pessimism, the darkness, the clouds, seems to become more prominent among composers, at least, as they begin to realize that they had no answer for the inevitable, for death, for the darkness. If the Uberman had swept God aside, death appeared to be a more stubborn obstacle. So once we get into the 20th century now, cultural Europe is a fascinating melting pot. It's way too hard, complex to give generalizations about this. But there's a significant amount of optimism around with the dawn of a new century. But that met with increasing pessimism of late Romanticism, at least in music. And so we arrive where we began this week, in a Paris theatre, 29th of May 1913, the premiere of a new ballet by a young, exciting Russian composer called Igor Stravinsky. It must be quite a sight to see hundreds of theatre-goers in their best evening wear, their dinner jackets, and their ball gowns rioting at the outrage of what they were seeing and hearing that night. And what was it exactly that they were seeing and hearing? Because this is the bit that fascinates me. They were seeing a choreographed setting of scenes from pagan Russia, the subtitle of The Rite of Spring, in which pre-Christian Russian people celebrate the onset of spring, blessing, sanctifying, becoming one with the earth. A young girl is chosen, interestingly, by fate, and honoured before the invocation of the spirits of the ancestors, and the chosen one dances herself to death in the famous dance of Kral, the sacrificial dance. This is strong stuff, isn't it? But do you see how everything we've listened to this week converges in this piece? Think of it for a minute. Think of all the musical examples we've listened to this week. We've had the celebration of the natural world. It's in Rite of Spring. Rite of Spring is interested in representing the natural world in sound. We've got the interest in the spiritual, but God, of course, has been swept aside because we're now all about pre-Christian ritual. Instead of Christian orthodoxy, we have the looking back into ancient myth in the search for meaning and answers. We have the dance. We have the ritual of the dance. We have a focus on fertility and sexuality. we have the examination of humanity, and we have a brutal and a violent death. That pretty much covers every piece of music we've listened to this week, I think. What were the audience hearing on that night in May 1913? They were hearing such a radical new musical language to contain and to represent, to embody all of this and so much more. And the ballet offended them deeply, visually, sonically. And yet, what, within 2-3 years? What was humanity doing to humanity in the battlefields of Flanders and the Somme, not exactly a million miles away from Paris? It's almost as though Stravinsky was telling a story which was far more than he used. His depiction of a godless world, certainly a world without the good God of the Bible, seems more than a little prophetic when Western civilization was forced to take a long look at its own mortality, not to mention its own morality, in man's own staggering inhumanity to man in World War I and beyond. I guess most people would say World War I was the final nail in the coffin for Romanticism. A new despair and pessimism emerges from the horrors of it, which couldn't be sustained by the old ideas. New philosophy was required for a new world, and that philosophy was to be modernism, and it's art modernity. But let's finish with what's commonly regarded as the final piece of the Romantic period of music. Stravinsky's Four Last Songs. Now, along with Gustav Mahler, who we started with tonight, Richard Strauss is seen as the towering figure of late Romanticism. Now, Strauss outlived Mahler by 38 years, which meant he died in 1949. And these four songs for soprano date from the very end of his life. They were published after his death, so really his final work. And they have a focus, appropriately enough, on this subject of death. Now, musically, you'll hear these pieces must have sounded rather old-fashioned in their first performance, which came in 1950. Having engaged in a good deal of musical iconoclasm in his younger years, Strauss's musical language stayed rooted in the late 19th century. And by 1949, which is after the Second World War, he must have cut a rather old-fashioned figure, musically, at least in some ways. But Strauss was no second-rate composer, and he couldn't be ignored, particularly when he wrote music of the quality we're about to hear. It provides an interesting contrast with the new language of modernism, which was well and truly flourishing by 1949. Remember the Stravinsky violin concerto we had, the later Stravinsky, in our first session. This is 14 years after that. Okay. What's an artist to do with the inevitable? This is the question, really, isn't it? With death. If one is not going to turn to God to find his answers to the inevitable, to physical death, one is going to have two choices, really. To submit and disappear into the darkness with resignation, like Tchaikovsky, like Vintaraisa, and so on. Or to seek to redefine death into something that is maybe, maybe it's not so bad after all. Something to be embraced. And that's what Strauss does here. I'd like you to read the songs, the texts of these songs. And then I'll play some or all of the music, depending how you're feeling. But let's just read these first of all. So here we go. First song, it's called Spring. This is a translation, it's from the German, of course. In dusky vaults, I have long dreamt of your trees and blue skies, of your scents and the song of birds. Now you lie revealed in glistening splendor, flushed with light, like a wonder before me. You know me again, you beckon tenderly to me. All of my limbs quiver from your blissful presence. Very interesting depiction of spring, given what Stravinsky did in 1913, and given what war just finished 4 years before this. So that's our most positive moment in the Four Last Songs, the first one. I'm going to just jump forward and make a little snippet of sound, but let me go. Here we go. September. You know what September's all about, the autumn. You know what's coming. The garden is mourning. The rain sinks coolly into the flowers. Summer shudders as it meets its end. Leaf upon leaf drops golden down from the lofty acacia. Summer smiles, astonished and weak in the dying garden dream. For a while, still by the roses, it remains standing, yearning for peace. Slowly it closes its large eyes, grown weary. We're still talking about the seasons here, right? Interestingly, we've seen a bit of the seasons earlier in the week. Notice the poet, by the way. The last, these first three are all Hermann Hesse. And here's the third one, also by Hermann Hesse. While going to sleep. Now that the day has made me so tired, my dearest longings shall be accepted kindly by the starry night, like a weary child. Hands cease your activity, head forget all of your thoughts. All my senses now will sink into slumber, and my soul unobserved will float about on untrammeled wings in the enchanted circle of the night, living a thousandfold. Heady stuff. Notice the name at the bottom of the page here. Heard that name before? Yes. We heard it this afternoon. Tom, you gave us some von Eichendorf earlier, didn't you? I can't remember the quote. I was trying to write it down. I didn't get it quick enough.
It's another pretty gloomy quote. So he said in 1815. Joseph von Eichendorf could write how, out of the magic incense of our making, a ghost of war will materialize, armored with the blanched face of death.
Wow. And he said that in
1815.
Wow. So, this is Strauss's setting of that same poet, that same writer. Through sorrow and joy, we have gone hand in hand. We are both at rest from our wanderings, now above the quiet land. Around us the valleys bow, the air already darkens, only two larks soar musingly into the haze. Come close and let them flutter. Soon it will be time to sleep, so that we won't get lost in this solitude. Oh, vast, tranquil peace, so deep in the afterglow. How weary we are of wandering. Is this perhaps death? Two mentions of wanderings there, verse 1, verse 4, notice that. Key image of the Romantic period. I'd like us to finish with this. Now, I don't know when we're supposed to finish. If I played all four of these songs, it would take about 20 minutes, so about 5 minutes each. I'd like us to listen to at least the last two. How tired are you? Do you want all four, or do you want just two? You've been very polite. But, you know, I will not be offended. If anyone needs to get away, if anyone's just a little bit music out, we can pick up three. I tell you what, we'll do all four, and if you need to leave or you need to go, I promise I will not be offended. So let's just see if I get back here.
And Strauss sort of isn't going to be offended.
Yes, he's not going to mind. It's gone. But do you see all those images? And you know, I'll keep the text up with every song. All those autumn things, the wandering things, all these romantic images. But there's a rather modern twist now to the attitude of death. You know, just, you know, this is sleep. This is something to be welcomed. Maybe this is not something so bad after all. Maybe Tchaikovsky needed to just, you know, well, you know what's going on. So, see what you think. They're short songs, stunningly beautiful. They might just change your life. See what you think.
Oh,
strikes with former songs. Just some of the musical features there while it's still a bit fresh in your ears. Did you notice the violin solo in the third movement? Don't know if you noticed the big violin. That's very, very significant. Strauss loved to write these big tone points of sort of biographical, semi-biographical stuff. And his wife, Pauline, the love of his life, who he married in 1894, and was to outlive him by less than a year, by 9 months, was depicted in all of these works by the solo violin. So when you hear the solo violin in Strauss, you think of Pauline, his wife, and his wife of 55 years at this point. Here are these two lovers, you know, who've spent half a century together, approaching death, having seen a lot of history in the first half of the 20th century. And Strauss is at pains to let us know who these people are, you know, in the text as they're approaching the sunset and so on. And then you must have noticed at the end there, did you see the good old-fashioned representation? Did you hear the larks?
Yeah.
Yeah. Vivaldi would have loved that. 1950. Wonderful. You know, I mean, and of course the two larks were a metaphor for these two people who are going to go. The question that people love to ask is this just Strauss's last four last songs, or is this four last songs for a bigger audience? You know, one very eminent Strauss scholar described this as Strauss's requiem for a lost century. You know, here he was in 1949. The world has changed. You know, he was kind of an iconoclast in the 1890s. The world has changed around him, and is it for the better? Oh, vast, tranquil peace, so deep in the earth. How weary we are of wandering. Is this perhaps death? He's speaking of himself and his wife, but is he speaking of all humanity here? What have we done? How weary we are of wandering. Perhaps this is the death of humanity itself. Two world wars, Hiroshima, a Cold War, a developing which, you know, in 1949 and into the 50s, people were thinking, well, this could actually be the end of humanity. This is the world that Strauss found himself living in after some pretty heady days in the end of the 19th century. You can decide on that yourself, whether it's a purely personal thing or whether he's speaking in this last great statement of Romanticism for a few more people than just himself and his wife. Yeah, and it was 15 years before the first performance of these songs in 1935. Stravinsky had said, I consider that music is, by its very nature, essentially powerless to express anything at all. Whether a feeling, an attitude of mind, a psychological mood, a phenomenon of nature, etc. Expression has never been inherent property of music. That is by no means the purpose of its existence. If I was in university, I'd say discuss. You could write that essay if you want on it. But, yeah. Any questions? Any reflections? Any?
The third movement there, it had something like an afterlife implied, like he's sending his wishes into the stars, and
right.
And then somehow his soul be in this enchanted circle of the night, living more deeply.
Yep.
So it's kind of, it feels like kind of a dreamy idea of the afterlife.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is the metaphor. Excuse me, as I understand it, this is the metaphor, isn't it? While going to sleep, but sleep is the metaphor for death. Mm. And so on your surface level, the day has made me tired. My dearest song, I just want to go to bed. We've all done that, haven't we? But he is a human being, and maybe this is a whole humanity who just wants to go to their bed. As we heard in Vintorais this afternoon, you know, he just wants to go to his grave. You know, I don't think that's really too much in, is it? Like a weary child, hands cease your activity, head, forget all your thoughts, all my senses now will sink into slumber. you know, and my soul observed will flow, you know, so yes, the idea of the dream is being lost in the, I'm so tired, dream of sleep, I never said sleep of dream, in the dream of sleep, and of course then that's the metaphor, isn't it, for death, you know, if I go to sleep in death, interestingly, you know, the New Testament uses that metaphor of sleep as death as well, as it always be. The enchanted circle of the night and so on, so be seeing a parallel there, you know, as death as being a positive thing. Of course, you know, that's the thing he's saying. This is something to be embraced. This is something to be welcomed. This is not something to be to rage against, like Tchaikovsky or whatever. This is something to be welcomed.
I wonder too, Hugh, looking at that third line, the first verse, "Be accepted kindly by the starry night." As though this starry night were death itself, or a father personified in that.
Right.
Accepting kindly this weary child.
Right. It's a beautiful image, isn't it? I kiss my girls to sleep every night, you know, kiss them to bed, and, you know. It's that lovely idea, you know, sweet dreams. Sogni d'oro, which in Italian, your dreams are gold. You know, as you dream of the stars and everything, you know, I could relate to this as a father. But yeah, of course, it's a very attractive idea, isn't it? Well, death is just the same. It's just like going to sleep. And is it? Well, maybe. We might, as Christians, we might say a qualified yes. Hmm. Yeah, but interesting perspective, isn't it?
Those are such beautiful songs. And I guess the soprano, but it's the soprano singing them.
Yes.
The voice is amazing.
Yeah. There's a wonderful story of the session, the recording session for that. You know,
is this what, early 60s music?
This were, yeah, I think certainly early 60s, maybe late 60s, I can't remember the date of the recording. Gundula Janovic, who was the soprano, and Karian, who I mentioned last night, Berlin Phil, went into the studio to record these. And recording classical music is infamously difficult, you know, because somebody scrapes a chair out of 90 people, you know, and you've got to do a retake, you know. It can be a very painstaking process, especially in analog, you know, when they're recording onto tape. You know, these days we can do all kinds of cool things with computers and editing and stuff. And they recorded one, two, three, four, one after the other. And Karian said, I think we can go on. So each one in one take. And then the violinist said, hold on a minute, I'd like another go at that solo. So they did number three again. And they went, and it was done in half an hour. And they set aside 3 days for a recorded session or something. You know, half an hour. And I mean, it rehearsed, of course, and everything, but you know, it wasn't from Cole, but it's still a remarkable tale of making records.
Can I ask you about this theme of death? Tchaikovsky conducted the Sixth Symphony and then dying 9 days later. The Mahler's line.
Right.
You're not quite a similar story, but it's not vastly dissimilar. So, you know, you know, his Ninth Symphony's premiered posthumously. He was dead at the time. Is that right?
I think that is right, wasn't it? Yeah, I think it was premiered in 1912.
Yeah.
After he died in 1912.
And he knew he was dying.
So yeah.
So another sort of the last move of it just sort of.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, I mean, Mahler famously puts his heart note into rhythm in the opening movement of the night.
We're looking at
Tom's stuff. I've got to get in touch.
Well, I'll stop recording.